And that was when we brought in Oswald, I think.
Yes, 1982.
Yeah. And the festival just really started to grow. Concessionaires now understood how to cater. The shows were running into daylight, so a breakfast trade started. Because the truth is, the tourists were scared to go back to the hotels from Jarrett Park in the dark.
Mm.
They would much rather sit on the grass and wait till the daylight, and then they would leave. And so that developed into a kind of a new format.
All night till daylight.
All night till daylight. So we did the pressure now on us to end by 3 o'clock.
Mm.
We just ushered that and just run the shows, you know?
But you forget a thing, man. You forget about 1982, what was one of the most outstanding development at Sunsplash. You don't remember?
No, remind me now.
The emergence of King Yellowman.
No, King Yellowman, was it 82?
Yes.
Or was it 84?
82.
82. What King Yellowman did was to introduce dance hall night.
Yes.
No, Thursday night was a throwaway.
Mm-hmm.
Wednesday, vintage.
Mm-hmm.
Against all the criticism and the reasoning, our reasoning was, look here, we may not make any money. But these guys, we are all here. Without what they did and their sacrifices, we wouldn't be here. So let's give them a little taste of the thing. Okay, Thursday night was whatever, because we're really gearing for Friday and Saturday when Kingston come in.
Yeah.
I'm telling you, that night, first of all, the first thing we realized was the tickets were going crazy. Ticket sales for Thursday night were going crazy. We're saying, what's going on? And the word came back that it was about Yellow. So by the time we got to time to bring him into the park, we realized that we were in serious trouble. We had almost a riot outside. People pressuring to get in. When the Benz came with him, we couldn't even open the doors. People were chasing the cars. So I said, drive back into Montego Bay, put him in a taxi, bring back the Benz. So we used the Benz as a decoy, driving around the park and people chasing after it while we smuggled him in with the taxi. It was chaotic. Jarrett Park had these two giant metal gates where the trucks would come in. And the gate was just moving with people. And Tony said, wow, let's get all the dogs from the security and line up because this gate is going to come down. And then it's when the gate came down, crashing down, the dogs bolted. It was a comical scene watching these security guards chasing, trying to catch their dogs. But that became the heartbeat of the festival. And that's where I personally have a dilemma, because I'm an old timer when it comes to Rocksteady and Burning Spear and Bob Marley. But this Charlie Chaplin, Papa San, Yellow Man, King Stitchy, Admiral Bailey,
Daddy Lizard,
they Flower were bringing Gun, in 5-6 times.
Red Dragon.
That's right. The amount of it was incredible, the kind of tour. We were getting 23, 25, 28,000 people trying to get into Jarrett Park. We realized that we could no longer operate there.
So, when 82 it was Jarrett Park, 83 it was Jarrett Park, 84. Bob Marley.
83 went to Bob Marley.
Bob Marley, yeah.
Because when we are struggling with Jarrett Park, the government is busy building a venue for the World Music Festival.
Yes.
And we couldn't get over that. We said, here we are, filling these hotels with local music. I mean, what better tourism can you get? You're not putting out any foreign exchange, and you're earning maximum for it. Your hotels are filled. And you are building a venue for some guys.
A one-week festival, World Music Festival, one-off.
One-off?
Yeah. I remember the World Music Festival. This was the first time we were seeing Rick James, the Grateful Dead.
Okay.
Jimmy Buffett.
You're right about that.
All of these major acts from
Peter Tosh. Peter Tosh cuss everybody.
Yeah. Peter performed too.
Yeah. Cuss everybody.
Yeah.
To spend a whole 20 minutes just cussing the shit still.
Yeah.
You know? And I must tell you, that was a shocker for us, that we could be here fighting with a venue that clearly was inadequate, with a growing local event that was doing everything tourism wanted.
Especially after Yellow Man and that
yes.
awesome performance in Jarrett Park.
So we decided 83 was going to be our fifth anniversary. Mm. We would go to the Bob Marley Center. But the Bob Marley Center was more than we could manage. It was just too big.
Mm-hmm.
It didn't have the boundaries. I mean, you could come in from the sea.
Mm-hmm.
We just couldn't manage it. We did a good show in America. We brought in musical youth as the youngsters and hot at the time. And we put together the Scatterlights. So, from that point of view, it was fine. But at the end of the day, we realized that, boy, we can't manage this place. So we went back to Jarrett Park. We went to Jarrett Park 84, 85. And we were lucky people didn't get killed. It was, dancehall night was, we welcomed it, but it was a nightmare.
Mm-hmm.
Just to manage the inflows.
The first dancehall night, when it was labeled dancehall night, you had about 45,000 people.
We had about 30,000 plus. You see, we used to go by what we could collect.
Yeah.
We never went by the estimates.
The actual amount, yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
And
but I'd say it would be about 45,000 people, man.
It was frightening.
Yeah.
I remember that we couldn't walk through the crowd to get to the stage. We had to walk right around the perimeters by the stalls just to get there. And we nearly lost. One night, we got this alarm that three tourist women had died at the gate. When we got to the gate, we found these two ladies lying on the ground. They had fainted. They weren't dead. But their friend was pinned under a barrier that had overturned and people were standing on top of the barrier and she was underneath it.
Wow.
Because the barrier had like 3-4 foot legs that gave her enough space.
Yeah.
So we had to untangle that crowd to get her out. And that's when we said, you know what? This can't work. Let's go back to Bob Marley Center. By which time Bob Marley Center had been totally abandoned.
Mm-hmm.
Everything was gone.
Mm.
Electrics, toilets, pipes, stalls, fences, all gone. It had a forest growing in it. Went to the government and I said, well, you can use it, but we're not spending a dollar. Whatever happens here, you have to do yourself. So with very limited resources, we took it on. Charles Campbell will always be a hero when it comes to the Bob Marley Center. We bushed it, put in back the toilets, 50 toilets, put in back all the electrics, rebuilt the stalls, rebuilt the offices. We rebuilt the Bob Marley Center over 6 years. Every cent we had went to some new part of it. And we shortened it, because it was just too big for us to manage. So we shortened it and built this ring road around that stallholders could drive around. And really, we had quite a successful run. We had refurbished the place to the extent where the UDC now turned to us and said, well, they want to get rent for it.
Mm.
And comically, the letter said that if we are not willing to pay rent on it, we should return it in the condition in which we received it, which was laughable.
Yeah.
Okay? So we ignored that, and we stayed there. In 1990, I think it was, we got formal notice to quit, because the UDC wanted the property back. They planned to sell it sell it as a housing development, which it is today. We went into a meeting with them, and we said, well, where do we go? They said they have this property at Catherine Hall that they are prepared to prepare and have ready for us that we can just walk in and do our thing. The engineers at the meeting, UDC engineers, said, well, Dr. Lawrence, I don't think that can work. It will take us a couple years maybe to prepare Catherine Hall to the level where these guys can just use it. So we suggested to give them another 2 years, which he did. Mm. Foolishly, we kept looking at Catherine Hall, seeing no development, and thinking, well, let's just continue on here. And then with, I think about 6 or 8 months to go, the UDC enforced our eviction. And gave themselves like 4 months to prepare the Catherine Hall. We got hurt in 2 ways. One is everything that was in the Bob Marley Center belonged to us. Mm-hmm. Every single thing, every light bulb.
Mm-hmm.
We went down to do an inventory of what we could salvage, and we were denied entry. UDC had posted security, who said, we're not allowed to go inside. They said, but everything there belonged to us. We said, well, you have to go, you have to get a letter. So we went back to Kingston, got this letter, because a week and a half, went back down, and everything was gone. Everything was gone. 50-odd toilets,
mm-hmm.
all the electrical fittings, all the construction of 1,200 stalls, of 120 stalls.
Mm-hmm.
Everything had been vandalized and taken out. Chain link fence, everything was gone. When you go to Catherine Hall, the engineer said to us, look, we don't have a parking area. How can we not have an area where people can park? Well, we have a parking area. We can't give you the 50 toilets that you have. We can give you 6. We didn't have time to put grass down, so you're on mall. We can't do a perimeter fence. So how are we going to keep people out? They said, well, there's a moat that runs along around the property that will keep people out. So these guys, they don't understand. When a Jamaican man wants to go to a concert, they tell him about him can't go through.
Mm-hmm.
So when we realized that the capacity of the place was maximum 10,000, we don't have no bathrooms. We don't have no fence. We don't have no parking area. We can't use this place. And that is how the move to Jamworld came about. Mm-hmm. Kemp Skeffrey had shown Charles this design for this virtually entertainment city out there. It was Jamworld was only one entity.
Mm-hmm.
There were clubs and theaters and shops and turned out that Jamworld was the only development out there. And our first year in Jamworld, 93, was okay.
Well, Yuma Sakela performed.
That's correct.
Yeah, I interviewed him.
Yes. Boy, I love that guy. He was such great, a nice
man, great
guy.
Man, great man.
Nice, easygoing
yeah.
guy, you know?
Amazing. when I interviewed him, I was surprised at how friendly and gentle
Absolutely.
And nice, you know, he was. Great personality.
Really a very laid
One of the highlights of my broadcasting career.
Yes.
You know, interviewing
yeah, the great Hugh
Masakela. Yeah.
It was a joy to deal with, man.
Yeah.
All the morning was a make sure I was split every morning. He made sure of that.
I know we're talking about the business side of the Sunsplash, but I don't want listeners to believe that Sunsplash was just, you know, what do we call the business side and the struggles and all of that. Let's talk about some of the performances at Sunsplash over the years. I remember the first time at when it was dubbed Dance All Night, and I think that was not necessarily, I don't think it was at Jarrett Park. I think the first time it was dubbed Dance All Night was Bob Marley. And that year, persons like Daddy Lizard, mm-hmm. Flower Gun, Red Dragon, General Trees, and others. I can't remember anymore.
Trees was
outstanding
every year.
Yeah.
Automatic booking.
Yeah. You know? I remember Gil Scott-Heron coming. Tell us some of the foreign acts that you used to bring down. 82, it was Aswad. Mm-hmm. I don't remember the year of Gil Scott-Heron, but I remember
83 was Gil Scott-Heron and the musical youth. Mm-hmm. And then we went to Steel Pulse.
Yeah. That was an amazing morning.
Boy, Steel Pulse. You know, it was even more amazing. Let's go back a few years to Jarrett Park.
Yeah.
When Blue Ridden Band came.
Ah, that was the start of the foreign invasion. the real impact of foreigners.
Nobody knew what to expect.
Yeah.
But we had their records. Mm-hmm. And everybody was waiting on Yellow. Mm-hmm. And people were there slumbering along. And these guys were on the stage and they started to chant. We don't want a white man. We want a yellow man. We don't want a white man. And the chant just kept going on.
Yeah.
And when Blue Ridden Band started, it blew everybody away. Because they were strictly into Coxon era of music.
Yeah.
And they were really absolutely outstanding. Till the chant changed. We want a yellow man. We want a white man. So that was the beginning of bringing in acts. There are so many acts that came in that I can't remember because you had acts from Germany, from Africa, from the States that would pay their own way down here just to be on the show. Mm. And the ones that really stick out in memory is Steel Pulse, Maxi Priest, Gwen Guthrie, not to forget Shinehead.
Yes.
Who called our bluff. Shinehead used to come on and tease us such. None of them can perform like me. And we didn't know anything about him. And
started his performance from the sound rig.
I'm telling you.
Yeah, from front of house.
From the front
and
of
walked
house.
And walked through the crowd. Yeah.
Blew everybody away, you know?
I can't forget. Bob Marley Center also, Black Uhuru, in the early morning.
Yeah.
I think the show ended at about 10 o'clock.
Yeah.
The sound. I think you had some. Byron Lee was in charge of sound that year. And brought in some people from the United States to assist.
Yeah.
And I was on the sound rig, and when the concert was just going and nobody was leaving. And Black Uhuru with Sly and Robbie was tearing down the place.
Yes.
And one of the guys from Miami said, listen, we have to make a plane. We have to leave and fade it down everything. That is how the concert ended that morning.
Those concerts are out of control. I remember the 83 one, the third world closed the show at something to 2 in the afternoon. Mm-hmm. I ran away. First thing, I'd see wind, so I could walk to the hotel. About 4 or 5 o'clock, I ran away. And I have to confess, I ran away because I had promised Chalice that daylight wouldn't catch them.
Mm-hmm.
Because they had constructed this beautiful lighting rig that said Chalice.
Mm-hmm.
And they had said, it has to be in the night.
Mm-hmm.
And as the concert wore on, and I started to sit down and say, you know what, I can't face these guys again. So I went over to the hotel, fell asleep. got up at 1 o'clock, said to my wife, what time did the show end? She laughed. She said, come here. I'm going to the door and we look. And dust is flying and music is tearing away. Third World is on the stage mm-hmm. at 1 o'clock in the day.
Yeah.
You know? And people tell me that those are their best Sunsplash, right? I don't know. But the foreign acts, let me see who else. We had Levi.
Papa Levi.
The one from England?
Yeah. There's a group called Macaw. Remember that group?
Both of those guys died.
Yeah. Yeah.
They were from LA,
mm-hmm.
you know, Rasmore. He helped us a lot.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, there were a couple of times when Rasmore really dug deep in his pocket and loaned us some very vital money. Yeah, this is Sunsplash became a family.
Mm-hmm.
It became a movement of an ever-growing group mm-hmm. of people. You know?
Yeah.
And I don't want to knock Sunfest, but there's something that we had that is missing. That kind of family.
Yeah.
You know? Anyway, things progress and we move on. What I haven't spoken about was taking Sunsplash out of Jamaica, which... Our first move was with Tony. Tony relocated to LA, started the tours up there, and built those tours over about a 6-year period, and we got to the peak. We were in Radio City. We were in America's top venues, some of which had never had reggae before. Mm-hmm. But Tony had molded the thing in such a compact and efficient unit. We were always on time.
Mm-hmm.
We always ended on time.
Mm-hmm.
The discipline was amazing. We toured pretty much all of North America. Then they went to London, did London Sunsplash. That's where we met Baxter Priest. Took the Scatterlights over there, Prince Buster, Heptones, King Sonny Ade. Beautiful event. 25,000 people. Sold out. Went back the following year. Sold out again. 25,000 people. And then the community rebelled. They said, boy, garbage in the streets. People park where they want to park. And so they applied to the council to block us, which they did. We went to Wembley the following year, couldn't get the stadium, so I went to the arena, sold out 2 shows at 7,500, easily. And then we went to Clapham Common, free show, sponsored by the council. The police estimate is 250,000.
Mm-hmm.
Brought out all the security London had, helicopters, horses, closing of tube stations. And they said to us, never again.
The power of reggae.
Never again.
What about Japan?
We did Japan in 85. We did 3 shows with massive crowds. And I tell you what Japan was to us. A revelation of technology.
Mm.
Unbelievable. All the set changes and the... All the hitches, technically, mm-hmm. that we were accustomed to.
Yeah.
Boy, the Japanese had it covered,
mm-hmm.
you know? The problem we had with the Japanese was we had a partner and we did Reggae Sunsplash Japan. And the following year, they changed the name to Japan Splash. And cut us out of the equation.
Mm.
So, we did 3 beautiful shows in Japan. And then we went through Europe. Amazing turnouts. I mean, we had to stay in like Holland for 5 consecutive nights of sold-out shows. On to Belgium, Germany, France.
The amazing thing now is that all of these countries have reggae festivals.
Have their own festivals.
Their own reggae festivals.
That's right.
So Rotterdam, which started in Italy,
yeah,
and move to Spain because they run them out of Italy, is one of the biggest.
Yeah, it's like a turn of events.
Reggae Jail in Belgium,
mm-hmm.
Germany have Summer Jam.
Mm-hmm.
You know, every European country have a reggae festival now, and they never had it before.
No, we opened all those doors.
Yeah,
you know, first of all, we would take part in ongoing festivals, so we'd get a few hours, and then. The festival became built around reggae. I still don't think that the powers that be understand the value of a Jamaican culture.
Mm-hmm.
Music is part of it, but the whole Jamaicanism of us,
it's the language,
commercial, you know.
The language.
It's a serious brand.
The mannerism.
Yes. The way we walk, the way we talk. Oh, I mean, the late night comedians, the black ones especially, have a ball at our expense, trying to imitate us, you know? And I just, I'm happy for Rebel Salute. Not that I've not been to Sunfest recently, especially since it's been taken over. But there's something about Salute that brings back to me the whole essence and feel of what Sunsplash was about, you know? And I tell you the truth, I look at today's music and I really wonder, is it my age or is it that we're not as hot as we used to be? Is it that dance hall has more or less taken over? It has its attractions and it has its shortcomings, musically, lyrically.
Mm-hmm.
And I also realize that all music is a part of our evolving culture. It's not something that's designed commercially. It's, it's how we are. It's how we live. It's how you know.
It's organic.
Right. So, in a sense, you can't too direct it because it's not as commercial as you'd like it to be. You have to really go with it.
Yeah.
You know? And what I also realize is that it continues to grow.
Mm-hmm.
You know? It's not like Bossa Nova, Congo. Reggae is just...
It's less dynamic. Jamaican popular music is just dynamism.
Mm-hmm.
And it's unique in that sense because, as you said, it continues to grow.
Mm-hmm.
As an academic, I call the creation of our Jamaican popular music a creative echo chamber, which just continues to grow and grow and grow and grow and evolve in a very organic way. You know, and I think sometimes we're at a point now that we are kind of stagnant because we don't understand the process of the making of Jamaican music. And so, for instance, now I believe that we're having an identity crisis because the music that we're doing is not necessarily what we could label dancehall in the strictest sense. And the problem is that there are different while you can't label Jamaican popular music just by one label, because you have reggae, reggae always there. You have, although we don't have a rocksteady band, rocksteady is always in the mix. Ska is always in the mix. And dancehall is always in the mix. But what we have done, I believe, and quite erroneously, is to label everything, the culture, the movement, the music, although it's evolving, we're still calling it dancehall.
Mm-hmm.
And it's bigger than the dancehall label. And so I think we are at a crossroads where we need to identify that the music is continuing to grow. And we can't label it the same way. We can't call everything that comes out of Jamaica reggae or dancehall. Give an example. Some people call everything that come out of Jamaica reggae, especially from the outside. And so dancehall had to fight for a space at one point. And now we're making the same mistake. And although the music is moving in different directions and being influenced by outside sounds and what is happening internally, we're still labeling it dancehall, and that label is inadequate.
But also, I remember there was a time when the dancehall lyrics could keep you abreast with every little occurrence.
Social commentary, yeah.
And I don't find that to be so anymore.
Mm.
And I also find that reggae lyrics are not universal. Like when Bob used to sing about African revolution, and we're not there anymore.
What's the best thing about being involved with Synergy and Sunsplash for you?
For me, it was a lesson that the will and the desire and the energy to do something is what you need more than the money.
Mm-hmm.
Because if anybody could have told us that with the capital of $9,000, which is what we had, that we could build a brand, but although we are no longer involved in that brand, 40 years later, it is still recognizable, you know? And so the lesson to me and to young people is, start. Start. Don't just sit down and think, boy, if only, and start. Jump off for the diving board into the water. You will learn to swim.
What's the biggest regret?
My biggest regret is the lack of recognition of a powers that be of what this music can do and has done. For instance, I really wonder economically if the selling of the Bob Marley Center on a one-off to a housing developer is more beneficial to the government than an event that filled your hotel rooms every year. Let's talk straight dollars now.
Mm-hmm.
20 years that we would have been there, because let's face it, the capacity of Catherine Hall is 10 to 12,000. It has its natural limits. Where we were expanding beyond our borders. You know? And my regret is that, you know, things like GCT. Government never used to charge GCT on concerts, you know. They started with us and they went retroactive. You know? We borrowed. Let me tell you something that happened to us in 86 or 87. We used to pay payola. Editorial payola. I'm not talking radio now. Entertainment writer. Ter. I didn't say writer is either. Because you know who I'm talking about.
Yeah.
And we were going so well that we said, you know what? We're not doing that anymore. And the response to that was a full-page article on Dance Hall night Thursday. The Star came out in red. Sunsplash disaster predicted. The well-known psychic predicts that the Bob Marley Center will sink at midnight. We had already sold 17,000 tickets in advance. And we had to run and shut down our ticket offices because people wanted their money back. And so we came up well short on that dance all night. And that rebounded to going back to the bank, borrowing $1 million Jamaican dollars at 23%. In came that FinSAC era, and we ended up at 92.5%. Couldn't pay that. So we were faced with nearly $6 million of GCT, back taxes, and we were faced with a bank loan that was escalating by the minute. And so you asked me about regrets, and I'm saying, good God, can't the powers that be recognize the jeopardy that this group is in, recognize what we had done to that point, and say, well, how can we work this out in some other way? No, sir. So we went belly up.
Mm-hmm.
We went belly up, you know. Even the treatment of the refurbishing of the Bob Marley Center. How can you justify that you can build a Bob Marley Center for a foreign promoter who comes in for 1 year only? And when your locals want to use it, you tell them, boy, you have to spend your money, you know. Or we're not spending more money on it. The whole, it seems to me that we never ever, in the minds of a lot of people, got beyond Rasta Ganja.
Mm-hmm.
That's what we were.
Mm-hmm.
You know? So, it's just so sad to see that narrow view. And I said that because in the middle of what we were doing, Carnival started.
Mm-hmm.
Baron had to be turning down sponsors.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I mean, that's where our values were.
Yeah.
For the powers that be.
Ronnie, we could go on and go on.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's been enlightening and it brought me down some serious memory lanes.
Yes, we had good times.
Yeah, man. Yeah. Yeah, overall, Sunsplash was a great institution. You guys were pioneers. You made a major contribution to the development of Jamaica. And I mean that sincerely, that you guys did what a lot of other institutions did not do, you know. And so we have to congratulate you for that.
I appreciate that.
You know, we know you're going to get the recognition and honor that you all deserve.
Well, I've got some recognition. I've been awarded. I've got a, what you call it, from the government. But my regret is that when I got that award, I said to them, can't it be an award to synergy? I said, no, it has to be an individual.
Mm.
And the truth is, we never really broke ourselves down into individuals. Mm. We were synergy. We were just Tony Dunn, John, Max, and myself, you know? So that recognition of which you speak goes to a bigger family beyond just me.
All right, Ronnie. Good talking to you.
Thank you, sir.
All right.
My pleasure.
Great.